Good evening, everyone. I am super excited to see you all here today, especially because today is the first presentation of a series that we're going to be doing on behalf of Kansas City Latin Jazz Orchestra and Allegro Music School here in Belize. This collaboration project that was made possible thanks to the U.S. Department of State, with funding provided by the US government and supported in implementation by IREX, the Wildlife Network. Actually, Cynthia and I met because the Kansas City Latin Jazz Orchestra was my host organization during the Wildlife Fellowship in 2021. So I'm super excited to get started today with this Jazz History 101 presentation. I also want to welcome, apart from the Allegro students that are here, I know there is a lot of friends and a lot of music teachers from other music schools all around the country. So welcome and thank you for accepting the invitation to be here with us today. Also, friends of the community, welcome, and I hope you enjoyed today's presentation. So I want to present to you the guest speaker for this evening. We have Cynthia Ammerman. Cynthia Ammerman is the executive director of the Kansas City Latin Jazz Orchestra and owner of a historic preservation consulting firm where she works in Las Vegas, Kansas City, and the Eastern United States. As a jazz historian, she has researched the origins of Kansas City jazz to the Latino and immigrant experience. And since 2014, she has been a guest speaker for classrooms across Kansas City and the Global Ties Network on jazz history, civil rights, and historic preservation. Ms. Ammerman was an inaugural education fellow with the Kauffman Foundation 2019-2021, and authored the National Endowment for the Arts grant that will support a commission project with Latin jazz pioneer Eddie Palmieri. She's the co-founder of the Latin Jazz Institute with programming in Kansas City, Las Vegas, and Santiago de Chile. With that said, I want to welcome Ms. Ammerman to today's presentation, Jazz History 101.
Thank you so much. How are you all doing? Good evening. A good wave from everybody? Bear with me, I'm going to share my screen here. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. I'm Cynthia Ammerman. All of those things are true. I am currently in Las Vegas, and I have been a historian and jazz historian for since about 2013. And I'm happy to be here and finally get to meet some of you, some of the students, and see some of the faces that I've heard about over the collaboration and learning more about Allegro Music School. The Latin Jazz Institute and the Kansas City Latin Jazz Orchestra. We have a heavy out a big outreach with us being in Kansas City for the last 25 years through Pablo Sanhueza, the artistic director's work as a percussionist and jazz educator. Here, full screen mode. There we go. Now we can get cooking here. So Jazz History 101. So this here is going to introduce you. This is the Kansas City Latin Jazz Orchestra. The orchestra is has been Pablo Sanhueza. He's here on the timbales. He's been a Latin jazz artist in Kansas City for 25 years, and he's originally from Santiago de Chile. And the Most of the musicians you see on stage with him in this photograph are his apprentice musicians. Some of them come from formal training in music since they were from young children, some of them your age, and some of them have just been studying music for one or two of them just been studying music 1 or 2 years under his guidance. So we are performance and education based. So this is the performance side of the orchestra. And this is our work in the community, our performances in the community. This is at the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art in Kansas City, Missouri, where Pablo has presented his orchestra many times. This particular event, I think we had about 700 people up and dancing salsa and cumbia. So it was quite the day. So today we're going to do have a Jazz History 101. Y'all, this, is it best if I keep everyone's, if I look, do you typically do Q&A during the conversations, or do you want me to just kind of go through and do Q&A at the end?
I think you could go through, and then if anybody have a question, remember there is a reaction buttons. If during the presentation Perfect. You have a question, I could monitor that on the chat, or if you press the reaction button, I will be looking for you.
Perfect. Then I'll just keep going. Thank you so much. All right. Today we're going to learn about what is jazz, the nature of jazz, the growth of jazz, and about key people who from the American experience, and that the African diaspora of what we came to know as jazz today. So what is jazz? Jazz is Black America's music. We know that the history of the slave trade from Africa to the Americas is what became the music known as jazz. Slave trade took people to South America, Central America, the West Indies, or the Caribbean, and then what we're going to look at here is really that history of the music and those traditions that Africans kept with them, and what became known as jazz, and how that was very kept them rooted in their identity. So jazz is Black America's music, and it's rooted in spirituals and tradition, and of course that lineage and the traditions of Africa, by taking European instruments and using European instruments to make a new sound. And all of this combined is very innovative, because it's very survival and peace, bringing your internal peace to yourself. So this map here shows us the global connections with the slave trade. And so here is North America. So next here we have the map of the United States, and this is really shows the what we would call the migration and the formation of jazz geographically in the United States. We know that it's important that New Orleans was a port city, and through those ports is where the slave auctions and the markets and the plantations of the South really had this influx of people coming from being brought from other places into what was then known as what was the United States. So New Orleans was the first main city we're gonna look at, and then the Kansas City is what we call. So we have, there's four cradles of jazz: New Orleans, Kansas City, New York, and Chicago. And I'm adding San Francisco because it becomes really important to the latter history of modern jazz. So, but this map here is important because it shows that the eras of the United States, how it changed over time culturally. And you can see that the cities in red are the key destination cities where African American and former slaves had to make their homes. And so this map shows over time how those communities had to either leave because they were forced to leave, or forced either for work so they could feed their families. And so we see New Orleans, we have New York City. You say that's a big area, geographical area to travel and still have a similar culture. So this jazz timeline here just kind of gives you a snapshot of what the time period we're going to look at. And this is, of course, Jazz History 101. So we're going to do an overview of a big period of time, about 60 to 70 years. And so coming out of that, after the Civil War and into the 1890s is when more of the commercialization of some of music becomes more popular as cities are growing in the United States, and more families and churches can afford pianos and afford instruments. And so music becomes a part of culture and everyday life in the city and in country life through your church.
Hello.
Is it possible? Thank you. Let's make sure we are all muted. Thank you so much. So just this timeline is about 60, 70 years, but we're going to just do an overview through this time period. But this shows you the evolution from ragtime, the blues, and then the different subcategories within each. So blues, Dixieland, swing, the bebop, and then the modern era kind of encompasses this latter part of bebop and Latin jazz. So the growth of jazz in 1900 to the 1920s. So I'm gonna just go to another. So where the first era that we're gonna look at is ragtime, and I'm gonna play a song. So raise your hand if you've ever heard that song. Excellent. You have a great music school. So that is ragtime. And the composer of that song is Scott Joplin. And he, my mercy. Trying to get back to my screen. He actually lived in St. Louis, Missouri, close to where I grew up, in Kansas City, and he became very popular in what's called Sedalia, Missouri. And ragtime is that sound of the piano, and often it's that syncopated sound. So you have the syncopation, and then you have the lower sound in the bass of the left hand of the piano is just going back and forth, and keeping that rhythm. and keeping the bass line. And it mimics a little bit of the sound of like the tuba with the bass line. And then in the right hand, the piano is playing the syncopation. It was da 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 da. That's the syncopated sound that you hear. And ragtime is really consistent, and you have to really study it hard. I've spent a couple summers studying ragtime purely, and it was a challenge coming from a classical piano. But ragtime, as you see, so Scott Joplin was born in 1868 and he died in 1917. Now the word jazz, as we've come to know, that the word jazz is documented possibly around 1914, 1917 for the first time it was really used as a word to refer to the music and the culture. So, but if you notice, this song is a precursor to what we become to hear as jazz music. So then out of ragtime, we'll say, is its cousin of the Dixieland sound. So the Dixieland music starts to incorporate not only the piano, but it starts to incorporate more of the orchestra and the band brass instruments. So you see in this picture, Mammy Smith and her jazz hounds. And this picture is about 1918, I think. But you see the instruments of carnival and the instruments of orchestras. And so we have the bringing together more of that European tradition of the band, the formal band and the community band in the streets and in concert halls and in the community. And you also notice there is a violin player. This was very common. Mammy Smith played in New Orleans and in the Delta. And that connection with New Orleans, with that Creole culture and the Caribbean, you get that influence of the Caribbean flavor. So there's a clarinet, a trombone, trumpet, piano, and then Mammy Smith did the vocals. So we're gonna pop back over here and listen to Mammy Smith's jazz hounds and some Dixieland music. Now, when we get to the end of the presentation, we can talk about we can even go back and listen to some of the sound clips again if you want, but I want you to take note on what you heard in The Entertainer, the first song, and then the second song by Mammy Smith, Jazz Hounds, and see if you can tell me some of the similarities and the connections between ragtime and Dixieland and how you can see that the music is connected and change over time. So another, what takes shape is in the Delta, and all of this is all jazz and blues are cousins, maybe even a married couple, but we have the sound of the Delta, which is the blues. And this is a very soulful sound, and you're gonna start blues is rooted in the storytelling aspect. It's very connected to storytelling and discussing, singing about life. And that instrument, the two instruments important to blues are the voice and the guitar. And Muddy Waters, who was born in 1913, lived all the way till 1983. He was with us for a while making music, but he's a blues king, and in bringing the Delta music. So again, keep a note of what you just heard with Dixieland and with the Entertainer, and then we're going to listen to Muddy Waters. There's another instrument that we'll point out, maybe the harmonica, that's important to blues that I didn't mention, but you can hear that sound. So after we're in the heavy end of the blues, well, the blues, I should say also, that song that I played was a little later with the electric guitar. Early blues, obviously, was primarily the acoustic guitar. There's lots of legends about the acoustic guitar and blues. But that song was later, but it's still the same feel and in that essence of storytelling and just that four count. Dun, 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 dun. Straight. And that's very, very important to keeping the groove in blues. So we're going to continue on with our growth of jazz into the 20s and 40s. So we're going to call this the golden era of jazz. And this is really where I come from in Kansas City. Jazz is the late 20s and 30s and 40s was really, the growth of, was the birth of the big band and the swing era of jazz. And Kansas City and Chicago and New York City are your big orchestras, dance bands, swing, you name it. This is when you start to see jazz and these orchestra band leaders. The orchestras became known by primarily the key band leaders. And so the band leaders start, getting their own popularity, and you start seeing more of a culture and jazz in Hollywood movies and jazz and big bands in advertising, and not just in the theaters and dance halls. So this is when the culture starts becoming a little bit more part of the everyday as more train travel is happening, and it makes it easier for people to connect between the cities of the United States. During this time period also, we have the Great World War I and had just ended. And that was a very important date to jazz because the soldiers who fought in a war in Europe, they come back to the United States and they have experienced other cultures being in Europe. And then vice versa, we take American music into Europe. So all of this time period is very important in the 20s and 30s, and you see this, the travel and, you know, more experimenting with music, but also experimenting with culture and the and what music and the aesthetic, we'll say aesthetics, but what you know, the clothing, the food associated, the buildings associated with jazz. So the big band and the swing style is king during this era, but we have Miss Ella Fitzgerald, who I think I mentioned that, you know, band leaders and vocalists were very important because they become the front. They come the front face of what the public and what music lovers are seeing for jazz. And Ella Fitzgerald is the king or the queen of swing, excuse me. And she was born in 1917, so right at the end of World War One, or right before World War One, and she died in 1966. And through this whole time period, from the time she was, I think, 16 or 17, she was adamant, and she sang with just about every main orchestra she could. She led her own, had her own ensemble, and flew all over the world until I think it's about 6 months before she died. She was the queen of swing. So let's listen to Miss Ella here. Well, maybe not. Where'd it go? We good?
Heaven, I'm in heaven.
Not what I wanted.
Never cared much for moonlit skies. I never winked back at fireflies. But now that the stars are in your eyes, I'm beginning to see the light.
Apologies for that. I didn't want a club mix of Ella Fitzgerald.
There's a saying old says that love is blind. Still, we're often told, seek and you shall find. So I'm going to seek a certain lad I've had in mind. Looking everywhere, haven't found him yet. He's the big affair I cannot forget. Only man I of with regret. I'd like to add his initial to my monogram. Tell me, where is the shepherd for this lost?
So this is Ella Fitzgerald singing a little later. She's singing the music of George Gershwin, which the Gershwin brothers were Jewish composers who did a lot of Broadway music. We're gonna do, so Ella was known for her her scatting. And so that is important to her contribution to jazz. So this should be a good, this next song, A Tisket A Tasket, will be a good example of pure Ella.
A tisket, a tasket, a brown and yellow basket. I send a letter to my mummy. On the way I dropped it, I dropped it, I dropped it. Yes, on the way I dropped it, a little girlie picked it up and put it in her pocket. She was trucking on down the avenue, but not a single thing to do. She went peck, peck, pecking all around. When she spied it on the ground, she took it, she took it, my little yellow.
So elements to notice in that song are Ella's, she's telling a story. She's telling a story in the lyrics. And if you're listening to the sound of the orchestra, they have the swing sound. You hear that in the rhythm, in the groove, and you hear that in the drums, and in the rhythm of the horns. So all that swing, and it's a very specific count. And so she's singing off of those beats.
Basket, and if she doesn't bring it back, I think that I will die.
All right, so that is Miss Ella. So Duke Ellington, he's one of the first major composers and band leaders that we of the jazz era. And what you're hearing Ella singing, this would be the orchestra you're seeing with Mr. Duke Ellington here, would be about the size of the orchestra she would have been singing in front of. So Duke Ellington was a pianist, and you'll notice during this time, orchestras have white musicians, they have black musicians, they have Latino musicians. Very rarely, depending on the, and this is very important to note in American culture at that time, because there were most orchestras were segregated between black and white musicians. So let's listen to Mr. Duke Ellington.
Thank you.
expressive, more artistic even, for the air. Free. He's improvising over the other solo. It's very important, improvisation in jazz. He's layering. He's layering it in this song. It's just too good. Okay, so we have two icons of the big band in the swing style, Ella Duke Ellington. And then we have Mr. Benny Goodman, who was a Jewish clarinetist. He was a band leader, and he was really important because, as I mentioned, segregation was, which is where black people and white people cannot be in the same places. And so black musicians and white musicians didn't play together in certain locations. So, but Benny Goodman, he was Jewish, and even Jewish, there was Jewish orchestras, there were black orchestras, there were white orchestras, and Benny Goodman was one of the first to say forget some of that and bring everybody and bring more people together. And so he was, as you see, he's here with Mr. Hampton playing the vibraphone, and he broke some of those barriers in bringing black musicians to play in his ensembles and his orchestra. I bet most of you know this song. Sing was actually composed by Louis Prima of New Orleans, who was a trumpeter born and raised in New Orleans, and later became really important to that crossover, the blues jazz rock in the 40s and 50s. And he was one of the main entertainers here in Las Vegas and kind of the godfather of the big shows here in Las Vegas. So Louis Prima wrote that song, and Benny Goodman really made it famous. So we're going to come out of the 40s a little bit. We're going to do a little bit of crossover. Let's see. I'm just looking at the comments real quick here, seeing if I've missed anything. So we're going to come do some crossover in the 40s and with the 40s and move into the 60s with the modern era of jazz. So here in this pictures, we have Charlie Parker, who's underneath the phrase bebop into modern. Charlie Parker was born in Kansas City, Kansas, just a mile away from where I used to live at in Kansas City. His house is no longer there, but one of the old apartments he lived in one of his old Kansas City apartments is still existing. Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie are important to the development of bebop. And we have the different feel of moving into the modern era of jazz. Bebop really it takes shape about 1940. By 1940-41, it's documented that this new sound comes out of the experimentation with Parker, Gillespie, Miles Davis, Clifford Brown, Max Roach, and some drummer. They all meet. I think their first meeting that they really played with solidly was for a gig in Chicago, and that's kind of where they all came together initially. And then they worked a lot. They really lived in New York City during this time period, and this is where bebop really is shaped. And you know, you have New York City here, and then it is not only the Harlem Renaissance and the sounds of bebop that you see, but it's influenced by other cultures, as we'll talk about just shortly. But let's listen to a song by Charlie Parker real quick, so you can hear the difference between bebop and swing. Of bebop and Charlie Parker. So also important to the modern era of jazz is that Thelonious Monk, who was a pianist and composer, and really took improvisation and messaging for, you know, we talk about this era in the United States, the civil rights movement is taking off and taking shape. And the Thelonious Monk and Max Roach were very key to their artistry, really reflected the moment of the Black American experience during this time. And they were very, their music, they made sure that is what their music reflected. So I think we're running short on time, so I don't think we're going to be able to get into all of it here. I want to leave time for question and answers, or Q&A. So just kind of want to give you a little taste here. So also in the modern era of jazz, you have the development of Latin jazz, which takes shape in New York City in that culmination of the African-American neighborhoods and the Harlem Renaissance, and the El Barrio, the Spanish Harlem, which in the Bronx, and and it's the same the very same proximity where the Harlem Renaissance was taking off. So you see, you have Puerto Ricans, you have Cubans, you have Haitian immigrants who are coming to living in New York City, and we start taking the shape of the cross pollination of the swing and bebop, and the traditional music of Latin America and the Latin rhythms and the percussion instruments. And so we're really gonna, next week you're gonna get a whole immersion just on Latin jazz history. And Pablo will do some demonstrations with percussion, but so I'm gonna play one song. So we have Tito Puente, I'll just go back. Tito Puente, who was the, you know, major and iconic in bringing together the Palladium ballroom and the dance music. So dance was key in the swing era. And so with the Latin music and Latin jazz, that becomes even almost more important, and you see it more today. Dancing has not been separated from the feel of Latin jazz and Latin music. We'll do one last example here. Oh, I just want to say, so Chano Pozo was Cuban born, and he was born in 1915 and he died in 1948, but he was the first really to play the traditional Cuban rhythms with that jazz setting. And it's really, really important to make that notation. So our last song we're gonna listen to is gonna be a little snippet of Tito Puente. So you can hear the difference between the swing era, bebop, and Latin jazz. This song is from 1953. And so it's about the same time that, just a couple years after the Charlie Parker song we just heard. So just kind of keep that also in mind too, as you're thinking about how the music has changed over time and how different the music sounded at the same, within the same couple years. So Pablo is going to give you the full scoop on the Latin music and Latin jazz specifically next week. But here's just some other photographs. The Palmieri brothers were very important to the development of Latin jazz. Eddie Palmieri, seen here clapping, is still alive. He's 86. This is whom we're working with for the composition. with the orchestra, but his brother, Charlie Palmier, they were both pianists, and they were very important to that, the history of Latin jazz specifically. And then we have Cal Tjader, who was born in St. Louis, Missouri, and he takes off and really shapes the sound of the West Coast jazz sound in San Francisco. All of these, Tito Puente, whom I just played, the Palmieri's and Cal Tjader, they've all played together and recorded albums together. So they were very, these are the key figures of that, of Latin jazz at that time period in the 1950s and 60s. And then one item I just want to leave with is how American jazz became known in our homes through the sound of Vince Guaraldi. And you know that he brings that, he's from San Francisco, the San Francisco jazz era of the modern era in the 50s and 60s. And this, he adds the American music of jazz to the soundtrack of our holidays. And I think that's important to know, because it's not, through the celebration of the Charlie Brown Christmas, jazz becomes more common in our American experience. So I guess we'll do just a little bit here. I'm sure the students will not recognize this. So I just want to just recap here. So we traveled from, well, we traveled really from the 1600s here for the slave trade. But for the evolution in the timeline of jazz, we looked at about 1900 into the 1960s. And so as you can see, and as you heard, how alike and different each growth of jazz is, and how they are all connected. I hope you can hear those connections. So we'll take a few questions. I think we have some time for a few questions. If we go over a little bit, I'm okay with that. But next week, while I have your attention, next week you'll get to hear straight from Mr. Pablo Sanhueza, and he will give you some demonstrations on the percussion instruments and talk more about Latin jazz history and his experience as a band leader and percussion instructor for 25 years. And I will take questions.
All right, student, all of those that were not shy at all in the comments, now is the time to ask. Now is the time to come up with questions. As Miss Cynthia was saying, next week, the 23rd, and we're gonna share that information later on during the week, we have a presentation with Mr. Pablo. He's a percussionist, and he's gonna talk all about Latin jazz, and he's gonna have a few demonstrations for you on percussion instruments and Latin jazz rhythm. So don't miss out on that, and look out for the registration form for that looking up at the end of this week. So now is questions time. If anybody has a question, you could raise your hand or unmute yourself. I think I see one person have a raised hand. Yes, Jason, you have a question, Mrs. Sittinger. You can unmute yourself.
So those are old musics?
Yes. Yes.
Very old, from old music from the 1920s?
Yes. Yes. You heard music from the 1920s. They're very old.
I have a question.
Okay.
How did they even get the instruments there?
That is a very good question. It's hard for some people to get instruments today even, isn't it? So the if you can think about how far back the 1920s are, just a little bit back further was the first recordings of sound about almost 30 years before that. So right in 1900, 1890. So remember I said that some of the instruments were European, and so the horns are easy to carry with you, right? Pretty easy. So the recording wasn't as easy as you could probably do on your phone, but they did it. they went to a recording studio, and everybody was in the same room, and they played as many times perfectly as they could.
All right.
Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Thank you, Jason, for your question. I'm gonna pass the mic now to Ruan, and you could go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question, Ruan.
Isn't a little old song from Atascadero a little nursery rhyme?
It is a nursery rhyme. You're absolutely correct. Very good.
Because I have heard that song from like a lot of times when I was more like around like 5, 4, like those.
Yes.
And I still like the song now.
Isn't it beautiful?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. I'm glad you knew that.
Well, now you have a jazz version of
it. That's right.
All right. Maija, you go ahead with a question.
Out of all those people we heard about, who was the most famous?
The most famous? Oh goodness. I think they're all equally famous at this point, but I'm probably going to have to say Charlie Parker at this point.
Thank you, Maija. And our last question then will be Nikolai. You could go ahead, Nikolai.
What did they use to record the music?
They used tapes. Later, well, the 50s, 40s and 50s, they used tapes, but they used what's called wax to make albums. Have you seen the big black circular albums? That's made out of wax. And so they would burn, like you would say, it was kind of burned with a needle onto the wax. And that's how they made the earliest recordings. Through the microphone. So the microphone picked it up, the needle burned on the wax, and then you got an album.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone, for your questions. I believe we all learned a lot about jazz history today. Remember that next week we have the Latin jazz presentation, and we have some percussion instruments presentations here. So don't forget to register for that. And I'm going to thank Miss Cynthia for her time today and partnering with us and presenting to all of you about jazz history 101. Thank you, Miss Cynthia. And thank you to all the students, families, and friends of the community that joined today's in our presentation. And we're expecting to see you all next week and more. So you could pass the voice. We'll meet here again next week to talk about Latin jazz. You have a good evening, everyone, and have a good night.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, sir.
Thank you so much. Bye.
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 Love the reactions too.
Everyone, I think.